Let's start with the announcement for the farmers. Government of India would provide 6,000 rupees per year for farmers with land holdings under 2 hectares. Critics and especially the opposition has of course criticized this. Is this amount really enough for the farmers?
Well, first of all, let me respond to the criticism and then I'll talk about the positive. What did the UPA do with the 10 years in power? A one-time loan waiver of 70,000 crores. Only 52,000 crores were waived. And the CAG report was that out of that 52,000 crores, a significant part of the money went to traders and businessmen and not to farmers. So a political group or a party which came out with a national hoax of this kind has the audacity to say that a scheme like this at a pan-India level is too little for people who did virtually nothing. Now look at what we've been doing for the farm sector. Rural roads 91% completed. Rural housing 2022, everyone will have a roof. 98.7% people in rural areas now have sanitation. Every willing home is having an electricity. Every poor man has switched over the cooking methods. Interest subvention on loans up to 12 lakh crores being given to farmers. The government is taking the burden of cheaper loans. Higher spending on irrigation, rural infrastructure. Then they get an indirect subsidy and a support. A very large number of them are within Ayushman Bharat, so free health care. Then you have a number of them who get the Manrega benefit, which used to be 28,000 crores during UPA, which is now 60,000 crores. Right to food, cheap ration, 1,90,000 crores. Now, over and above all this, the center says that when you buy your inputs, fertilizer, seeds, etc., I'll give you an initial financial support. Loan waivers are never a solution to the farm sector problem in the long run. And income support still is. We first announced that farmer will get input cost plus 50%. Many get it, but some, the markets don't give them 50%. So you are giving them this additional support of 6,000. And then you have a federal structure, you have state governments. If Telangana can announce, if Odisha can announce, I'm sure the other state governments can also announce. So please don't shed crocodile tears today for the farmers. If you also, the opposition also has several governments, let them announce similar schemes. I'm sure the other governments within their fiscal space will also consider this. And therefore you can top it up. And it's not that as though this is the sole prerogative or the responsibility of the center. We are in a cooperative federalism. Both center and states must cooperate. This is a huge amount that we are doing. And we are now as against a one-time loan waiver of 52,000 crores, which was partly eaten into by traders and businessmen. This is 75,000 crores in the first year itself. I'm sure it will expand in future years.
This kind of a support scheme for the farmers, sir, does the government actually now say that, agree that there is a crisis in the agri-sector?
Well, I think crisis is overstating it. The Indian farmer is really the producer of our food. His productivity levels have hugely improved. And therefore, in the last few decades, we've seen shortages becoming into surpluses. 4 years ago, pulses were in shortage. He's now producing it in surpluses, so the prices go. Now, he gets hit because he's producing more, that the cost goes down. And therefore, world over, the United States is subsidizing its farmers. The European Union is subsidizing their farmer. So everywhere, you maintain a balance between food prices and subsidizing the farmer, so the farmer gets an incentive for producing something. I think our farm sector still needs support, and I'm quite sure if the center and the states come together with these kind of programs rather than mere myopic slogans, which really will not give a long-term sustenance to the farmer, it can certainly achieve a lot more.
Now, not many Indians, like the citizens, have applauded this budget, the interim budget. They say it's a budget for everyone. It is for the farmers, it's for the middle class. But the opposition and the critics again say this is something to woo the voters. It's that Brahmastra that the BJP is using.
I think, let's be very clear. In the 2009 interim budget, Mr. Pranab Mukherjee, not even in the interim budget, but while replying to it, announced a stimulus package where he reduced excise duties 2% across the board. Well, the same argument was available then. In 2014, Mr. Chidambaram, on a number of products, including engineering products, automobiles, gave a duty rebate. The same argument can be taken now. Well, budgets are an essential part of any parliamentary democracy. So are elections. And if good policies of the government and the kind of fiscal space that we have created enables us to help the middle class. And mind you, India's middle class is being very vastly strengthened. I recently studied, went through a study. In 2018, we had a, 2005, I'm sorry, we had an 18% middle class. In 2015, it was 29%. In 2025, it's projected to be 44%. So within a generation, you will see a large majority of Indians graduating into the middle class. And if UPA gave inflicted a 10% inflation on them, which we've brought down, obviously the taxpayer also, his real value of money has declined. And therefore, exempting the smaller taxpayer, and mind you, his ability to spend more means a boost to the economy. What we give him by way of a direct tax benefit also comes back by way of indirect taxes because the purchasing power of India's middle class is improved.
Right. With such big ticket announcements, there must be a sizable impact on the income of the government. How would you possibly contain fiscal deficit at 3.4%?
Well, if you look up governments from independence onwards, and more particularly after the post-reform, no government, and I say this without fear of contradiction, has had a better record of fiscal prudence than we have. Our fiscal deficit, we inherited about 4.5, 4.6%, is down to 3.4. We had targeted 3.3, but because of this last minute 20,000 adjustment because of the farm expenditure, we've had to make a 0.1 compromise. Our current account deficits have been brought under control, inflation is under control, and therefore if you see our fiscal record speaks for itself. Because of all the anti-black money measures that we took, because of the entire direct and indirect tax departments being put online, because of the fact that we've now, after demonetization, after GST, the average we have been growing in our tax collections every year in the last 5 years has been in the range of 15 to 18% a year. Now, if my revenues are going up 15 to 18%, if my tax base is close to doubling in a 5 year period, surely the people who pay taxes are entitled to see the benefit of those taxes. And the benefit of the taxes is a growing economy, a booming economy, and on top of that, people getting tax rebates and people getting a better quality of life, a better infrastructure. So when we took over, the budget size used to be 5 years ago in the range of 14 lakh crores. Now, Piyush Goyal has today announced next year's budget size to be over 27 lakh crores. So the size of the budget itself has expanded almost a little less than doubling.
With the latest media report on the NSSO data suggesting unemployment at record high, what's happening with the jobs, sir?
Well, I don't think that's a report. That's a draft which has not been approved. Now, let me first use this opportunity to meet two disinformations which have been given. The first, jobs. If 7.5% is the average real GDP growth, and inflation is 4-4.5%, at the moment it's 2.19, then our nominal growth adding the two is about 11.5 to 12%. If the economy is growing over the last 5 years by a 12% nominal growth, and if you compound it annually, the size itself is expanding very largely, it would be an economic absurdity to say that such large nominal growth, the highest anywhere in the world, doesn't lead to creation of jobs. That can happen only in one eventuality, that your productivity levels go up to such an extent that even a bigger economy doesn't grow jobs. That is to say that here you had, take any industry, take your industry, a newspaper. It took us 500 employees to bring out a newspaper. Today it takes us 50. Even though our circulations have doubled, the jobs have come down. But have our productivity levels gone up to that level? Obviously the answer is no. There are newer areas of economy which are expanding. And also remember, if no job creation takes place, then there is social unrest. This has been a peace period as far as social issues have been concerned, and no major social agitation has been witnessed in the last 5 years. So I completely refute this argument that a 12% nominal growth on an average over 5 years will not lead to creation of jobs. The second argument, well, how did the GDP improve even after demonetization? Well, there were no settled models of demonetization anywhere in the world. And therefore, people were making off-the-cuff statements. Oh, it will lead to a 2% reduction in GDP. Oh, it may lead to a negative growth, etc. And our mindsets were all getting constrained by them. But what did demonetization eventually involve? People were earlier transacting substantially in cash. You buy goods in cash. The trader goes to the manufacturer or the wholesaler and buys in cash. The manufacturer buys his raw material in cash. And all this transaction chain went unrecorded. When all of them were compelled to deposit their money, 86% of India's currency, into the banking system, and now you had to give your credit card, now you had to have more recordable kind of transactions, except for the initial shock for a quarter or so, or maybe two, more recordable transactions, more digitization really adds to a larger economy. And therefore, the GDP had to go up. And my final response to this is, GDP estimates are estimates. Tax collection is real. If in 2016-17 and 2017-18, the tax collection was going up between 15-18% a year, that was real tax collection. So there was economic activity happening. You don't have a 15 or an 18% taxation growth without a corresponding expansion of the economy, which is an expansion of the GDP. Therefore, let's not get into these fictional arguments that GDP doesn't grow if monies are deposited into the banks. My assertion is absolutely to the contrary.